Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. We're going to get started. Thank you for attending the latest installment of the Option Industries Web Council's webinar series. My name is Nick Ziegler, and I'm a staff member here at the OIC. I'll be guiding you through today's session. We're glad you could join us to learn more about Options, the flexible, powerful trading tool. In today's webinar, Is Your Portfolio Playing Defense with Options? We'll be discussing how you can manage your portfolio's risk through the smart use of options. As always, we'll cover the material, as well as your questions, in a quick 60-minute session. Our instructor today is the OIC's Director of Retail Education, Mr. Joe Burgoyne. Joe has spent more than 3 decades in the financial industry and brings a special understanding of options and investments to our discussion. And now, ladies and gentlemen, Joe Burgoyne will bring you our topic today, Is Your Portfolio Playing Defense with Options? Joe?
Nick, thanks a lot. And as always, thanks to everybody for making time to join us today. I think we got a pretty timely topic here. In the month of February, our OIC topic for options education is risk management. And today, specifically, we're talking about defense with options in your portfolio. As those of you who are, somewhat close to the markets realize, the markets really have been, pretty remarkably volatile. After a number of years where we didn't have much volatility, certainly that has changed, both the equity markets as well as a number of the commodity markets as well. And some would argue maybe commodities driving equities, but who knows exactly how it's all interconnected. But we know we've got lots of movement, lots of volatility. And actually, speaking of that, the March theme for OIC is going to be the Greeks and the pricing components for options. So we spent a lot of time talking about volatility in the month of March here at OIC. But tonight, let's focus on defense with options. And, before I get into the slides, defense with options. So what might we be talking about? Obviously, we're talking about, downside protection. And so downside protection sounds like insurance. So as an investor, I guess you've got to decide. We've all got different insurance, whether it's auto insurance, whether it's homeowners insurance, whatever it may be, life insurance. We pay X for that. If we're talking about playing defense with options versus our portfolio, I guess, the key question is, how much am I willing to spend for that defense? Options, one of the great things about options is the versatility, and I hope, as we go along here, we'll go through, half a dozen plus different types of strategies, some straightforward. We're going to talk about just buying puts, but then we're going to talk about other things as well. So, for those of you just getting started, please be aware that the industry does put out a document called Characteristics and Risks of Standardized Options. It's important that you get a copy of that, either from the Clearing Corporation, OCC, or from your broker. For those of you who are really unfamiliar with OIC, we are the Industry Educational Cooperative that was formed in 1992. We've been funded for all these years primarily by the Clearing Corporation and then by the option exchanges as well. The Clearing Corporation, the OCC, is the largest equity derivatives clearing organization for the foundation of secure markets in the world. It was founded in 1973, and as I mentioned, OCC is the primary funder for OIC. The other members are the 7 parent companies. We're up to 13 exchanges, or 14 exchanges now, but we've got a number of electronic exchanges. Again, I'll just quickly, for those of you who may not know, these exchanges do make up the options universe. BATS is an electronic exchange out of Kansas City. BOX, an electronic exchange out of Chicago. CBO, the first exchange founded in 1973. ISE, the first electronic exchange. And I think the exchange that profoundly changed this industry back in 1999-2000. MIAX, another options exchange based in both Princeton and Miami, a group of ex-Philadelphia folks. NASDAQ has their exchange as well as the New York Stock Exchange. So they are the parent companies that join with the OCC to fund the OIC Education Initiative. For those of you who have heard me before, you've heard me say this is one of my very favorite slides. You know, it is the snapshot of the growth of the listed options industry. And we started back there in 73 in Chicago with 16 different companies. We've currently got over 4,200 different products that we list options on. So there's been an enormous growth in the list of the underlyings. When the industry started back in 73, there were only calls. The SEC had not even approved the put contract. That didn't happen until a few years later, either 77 or 79. I think it might have been 77. You know, we grew into four, five, six exchanges. But you can see in 99, 2000, 2001, option volume started to grow rather significantly. And I would suggest that that by and large was due to a couple different factors, one being the invention of electronic access to the options market, as I mentioned, ISE being the first electronic exchange. And from 73 to 1999, if you wanted to trade an option on an underlying company, you could only go to one of the five exchanges at that point. And then in 1999 in Philadelphia, Dell Computer was dual listed. And with that, all of the different exchanges started to list each of the underlyings. And so we got a combination of electronic access to the market. We got a dual listing, which meant that different exchanges could make option markets on the same underlying. That narrowed spreads, as did the efficiency of the electronic market. You know, that was the tech boom back in the late 90s, early 2000s, so you did have increased and improved platforms. And lo and behold, option volume went from 500 million contracts a year over the next six, 7 years to over 4 billion contracts a year. And last year we did just over 4.2 billion, averaging just shy of 17 million contracts a day traded on the option exchanges. So that's why, you know, this is one of my favorite slides. It just speaks to the growth of the industry. I was on the floor in Philadelphia from, you know, the early 80s up into the 2000s, spent a lot of time making markets on the floors and, you know, enjoyed the heck out of it. Options, you know, we talk of them. I always, you know, refer to them as financial tools. They oftentimes, I won't say they're misunderstood, but I think they are misrepresented as these very complex financial instruments. I would argue strongly that that's not the case. They're wonderful financial tools that, with a little bit of homework and stick-to-itness, I think are quite easy to understand. Without question, you get started with options, it can be confusing because, like any industry, you have to learn the lingo, and that takes some time. But the concepts themselves, if you can get straight, you know, a call and a put and the rights and the obligations, you're well on your way. So we use these option financial tools to really reduce risk, and of course that's the focus of our presentation tonight, playing defense with options. So reducing risk, can also use them to generate income, certainly because each option corresponds to 100 shares of the underlying. There is the whole idea of leverage, and then with that sometimes speculation. And with that, you get different trade-offs, and you know, we'll go through some of that tonight. Another slide that I really enjoy is this particular one. It speaks to the flexibility of options. Bottom right, it says options give you options. Well, you know, what the heck do these blue lines represent? Well, they represent potential profit and losses. So those blue lines, you know, around your horizontal and vertical axis, they represent the risk in the 18 different strategies mentioned. We're not going through 18 tonight, but a number of these strategies, the reason there is a lot of risk, a little risk, or no risk is the same in a lot of the different strategies because the concepts are the same. And that's what I will spend some time on as we go through these half dozen strategies or so. Keeping it simple, you know, how do we protect to the downside? Long puts. You know, a put is the right to sell stock at the strike price. Short call. Okay, we'll talk about that. Is that a good way to protect the downside? As I said, we'll talk about it. Bear put spread. bear call spreads, bear suggesting that, they're bearish positions, so you're going to make money to the downside or protect your portfolio somewhat to the downside. Straddles and strangles, we'll take a look at them. They're not for everybody, but certainly they are positions with options that can allow you to manage your downside for sure. Long stock, long puts, plural. So we'll talk about, we're long stock, and then we're long puts. Getting back to my initial comments, puts are insurance to the downside. How much do you want to pay for your insurance? And, we'll talk about that some. Back spread, that might be a position. This is a put back spread. Maybe a number of you have never even heard of a back spread. I would, at least going through it, because it speaks to the concept of long versus short options. I don't think that too many retail investors actually use the back spread. As a long-term trader on the floor, I'd say pro traders are more apt to do back spreads, but I think it's good to understand the risk-reward behind them. So we'll get into that and actually spend a little bit of time on the back spread. And we'll talk about a collar as well, which is a combination of two different strategies. So start off with, I'm not sure how many of you are familiar, first of all, with our website, optionseducation.org. If you're not, I would urge you, try to find the time to spend some time there. It actually can be somewhat overwhelming. We have an awful lot on the website, but a good place to start if you're getting a little bit along with options is to go to the position simulator. That's probably the fifth drop-down bar. I think there's 17 different pieces in that drop-down bar, and look for the position simulator. And you can plug in shares of stock, you can plug in different options, and then you can also change the number of options. You can add multi-leg strategies, you can change volatility, days to expiration. It's quite comprehensive, and what it will do is it'll show you, how you're going to do as the market changes. And the things that impact option prices are things like how much time to expiration, what are the implied volatility levels, the premium levels of your options, things like that. It's quite simple. You just move the bar and you can get a pretty good feel for, when a particular position is going to go your way. And that's why it's really just a way to do your homework. And this simulator, I think, can bring live trading to life for you without actually having your cash on the line, which can be a good thing. In terms of risk management and downside strategies, I think we'll start with a long put. Here we are, long put. Very straightforward. For those of you, again, who are just starting with options, we've got calls, we've got puts. Calls are the right to buy the underlying when you buy a call. Put is the right to sell the underlying. Again, we're talking about defense tonight. So if you own stocks, you might potentially buy insurance, and you can do that in a number of ways. But the most straightforward way is to buy, a put. And so as the slide suggests, you do have limited risk with a put, and that's because you are buying the option. And whether you pay $1, $3, or $10, the most you can lose is the price you pay for that option. So nobody wants to lose money, period, but insurance costs money. And, if you're just to buy puts over your position, you're going to, be laying out capital and have a debit when you buy those downside puts. So your loss is defined in advance. Again, it's the debit you pay for that option. Your downside profit potential, or in the case of playing defense against a portfolio, your offset. If your stock goes down, your put should go up, depending on the strike you have and the implied volatility levels, and that long put should offset some of the losses in your long stock position. That's the idea behind a long put. So, we could simply think in terms of, and here is, the position simulator. You can see that red line is at the axis where the horizontal and vertical lines meet. The debit you pay to the right side of that graph potentially is the premium paid for the put. And then as the stock goes down, that red line picks up because the value of that put increases as the stock drops. So just as an example, let's say we got a $50 stock. We could buy a put at the 45 strike, at the 50 strike, or the 55 strike. As an example, okay, again, stock's 50. If we buy the 55 put, it represents the right to sell stock at 55. Well, if the stock's at 50 and we can sell stock at 55, we know that put is worth $5, $5 of intrinsic value, plus, depending on how long you have, how much time you bought for that protection, it would be the $5 plus whatever the value of that time premium is. A less expensive approach would be the 50 put, which would be at the money with the stock at 50, and then the 45 put would be the right to sell stock at 45. So with options, you know, how much time and the strike price, very, very important questions. For those of you who've been in the space for a while, you know that's actually part of the fun and the challenge, trying to buy and sell the right strike prices. But that's the whole idea of a long put, just like any other insurance you have. It protects your investments. And then, you know, depending on the size of your investment, you know, you talk to your advisor, or depending how sophisticated you are, you know, you have to decide how many puts and how much money you might need to invest to offset that downside in your portfolio. So that's the long put. Short call, a very different blue line on the slide, as you can see. I mean, where that long put took us, you know, basically significant profits, and they'd be unlimited profits, except stocks can only go to zero. You know, on the left side of the put graph, you had significant downside profits. Here, you know, the profit line goes horizontal. And why is that? Well, that's because, as is the case with any option we sell, we can only make as much as we sold the option for. So you sell that call for $1, $3, $10 again. That's the most you can make. Big, big, big difference, though, between long put versus short call. You can see the bottom right of this particular short call slide, unlimited risk. So let's go back to our $50 stock. If you sell a call, you could sell the 45, 50, or 55 call. Let's go through it. The 45 call is the right to sell stock at 45. Well, if you sold the 45 call with the stock at 50, we know that call is worth at least $5, that $5 of intrinsic value plus whatever time value we have in that option. So maybe it's 5 plus $1, $2, $5, again, depending on how much time and how active that stock is. How much does that stock move around? The more it moves around, and a lot of stocks have been moving around a lot lately, the more it moves around, the higher the time premium is going to be. So selling the 45 call with a stock at 50, let's say the time premium was 2. Let's say, you know, we know there's $5 of intrinsic value, so we'd sell the 45 call for the 5 plus 2, $7 with a stock at 50. If the stock at expiration went out at 50, we'd have made the $2 of time premium. If it went out at 45, we'd have had, you know, the $2 of time premium plus the $5 of intrinsic value. We would have protected ourselves from that stock going from 40, from 50 to 45, and made an additional $200. You know, if we sold the 45 call with the stock at 50. Now, if the stock went to 55 and we sold that call at $7 at expiration, that call, that 45 call, the right to sell stock at 45 with the stock 55 is going to be worth $10. So we'd be out $300. So that's why, again, what strike you pick is very important. You've got a fair amount of protection if you sell the in-the-money call, but you've got unlimited risk to the upside. That's the thing you must keep in mind, unlimited risk to the upside. You sell the 50 call, it's just going to be all time premium. Maybe it's $3. You sell the 55 call, which is the right to sell stock at 55. You know, you'll get maybe a dollar or two of, depending on, again, the amount of time and the volatility, you get a dollar or two maybe for that option. So your downside protection is only the credit you take in. But, again, most importantly, your risk is, if you're just selling calls, could be unlimited if you are short more calls than you are shares of stock. So that's something you really need to keep track of. And again, with the position simulator, you can see the line on the left side, the red line goes flat because that represents the amount of premium that we sold the call for. We can't make any more money than that. But to the upside, if that stock takes off and we're just naked short calls and we don't have enough stock to protect us against the short calls, you know, we've got unlimited risk. So you always want to try to manage and quantify your risk to the upside or to the downside. So that's long put, short call. Two very, very different risk profiles. You know, again, with the long put, we're buying insurance, but we've got quantifiable risk. With the short call, we've got limited downside protection and unlimited upside risk. So, you know, please be aware of that and keep that in mind. Next, we want to look at the bear put spread. Okay, bear. So it's a downside strategy. The blue line suggests, you know, stock goes down, we're making money to the downside. Stock goes up, we're going to lose money depending on how much the stock goes up. So the bear put spread as the bear call spread, which we'll look at next, they're both vertical spreads. And a vertical spread is one where in the put example, we're going to buy one put and then sell another put at a lower strike. So that strike's either going to be at or out of the money, but always lower because in the bear put spread, we're buying downside protection. So we buy one strike and sell a lower strike, same expiration month, always same underlying stock, and this is always a debit spread. So, you know, like the long put, we're paying for this protection, but there's a big difference here. And it's always a debit because the put we buy is the higher strike, which always costs more than the strikes below it. So, you know, that's basically the vertical bear put spread. And you can see how the simulator represents it. The red line represents the long put. The gold line represents the short put. And at some point, they offset one another. And the way they work, let's go back to our $50 stock. If we have the stock at 50 and we want to buy a bear put spread, you know, again, it gets back to what strikes do we want to buy? We could buy the 50-45 put spread, so we'd be buying the at-the-money put and selling the put $5 out of the money. If, you know, the price of that put spread, the 50, again, is always going to cost more than the 45 put because the 45 is $5 out of the money. Maybe the 50 put costs $4. Maybe the 45 put costs $1.50. So we do that spread for $2.50 with the stock at 50. You know, $2.50 would typically be the price of that spread. But if we pay $2.50 for the 50-45 put spread, we know right out of the box the most we can lose, because we're buying one option, selling another, the most we can lose is the debit we pay for that spread. So if I paid $1 for the spread and the difference between the strikes, the difference here is $5. We got the 50 strike and the 45 strike. So we know that the most that spread can be worth is the difference between the strikes minus whatever debit we pay for the spread. So if I pay $2.50 for the spread and the stock goes to 45 or below, I know that that spread's worth $5 at expiration. So if I paid $2.50, I make $2.50. If I happen to be able to buy that spread for $1 and the stock goes down to 45 or below the strike, the difference is still $5. If I paid $1, I'd make $4 for that spread. If, on the other hand, I bought the 55 put and sold the 45 put. So that 55 put, again, with the stock at 50, that represents $5 in the money plus whatever the time premium is. So maybe I'd pay, say, $4 for that put spread, buying the 55 put, selling the 45 put. If I paid $4 for that put spread with the stock at 50, and it'd be somewhere in the neighborhood of $3.50 to $4, I know the most that spread can be worth, the difference between the strikes, $10, 55 to 45, minus the debit I paid. So if I paid $4, I could make $6. And that would offer, you know, some significant downside protection. But we know if we pay $4 for the spread, you know, we're risking $400 because each contract, you know, because each contract corresponds to 100 shares of the underlying, we know that the price, if it's $4, you got to multiply that by 100 for each spread we have, we'd be risking $400. So, you know, that's the bear put spread, another very sound approach to downside protection. The key is, you know, what strikes do I purchase and what months, you know, do I do the spread in? So that's the bear put spread. On the flip side, again, another vertical spread is the bear call spread. We buy one call and sell another. Now, the call we sell is at a lower strike. So the fact that the call that we sell is a lower strike means that the bear call spread is always done for a credit, and it's the case with all vertical spreads. You know, same strike, or same month, always same expiration, and, of course, different strikes. And with the bear call spread, you can see it's a very similar philosophy, except that we're doing this for a credit as opposed to the bear put spread, which we do for a debit. The bear call spread, let's go back to that $50 stock. Bear call spread, maybe we want to, depending on how much protection we need and how much risk we're willing to take on, we could sell the 45-50 call spread. Maybe we, and the stock's at 50, maybe we sell that for about $2 with a stock at 50, somewhere in that neighborhood. So if the stock drops, we'd have $2 of downside protection. We'd be protected down to 48. Below 48, we're going to be flat long stock. We could, you know, potentially sell the 45-55 call spread. So we'd get to do that for somewhere closer to, you know, $4.50 or $5. That would give us additional downside protection. If we were a little bit less bearish and just trying to take some money out of the market, maybe with a credit spread, maybe we sell the at the money, sell the 50 and buy the 55. Maybe we do that for $1.50 or so. Now, if we sell, you know, same philosophy with all these vertical spreads, the most they can be worth at expiration is the difference between the strikes, you know, plus or minus, depending on whether you're doing it for a debit or a credit, plus or minus the debit or credit that you're doing will give you your, you know, maximum profit potential. So, you know, downside defense, the whole idea of the bear put spread and the bear call spread are very reasonable strategies to consider. Far different. I mean, if we go back to our first two, you know, the long put versus the short call, long put, that was just, you know, it's wonderful downside protection, but all we're doing is buying options, where with the vertical spread, we buy one, sell another. The offset or the trade-off is that we don't have unlimited or significant downside profit potential. It's just the difference between the strikes. So that's where the trade-offs come in. How much do I want to pay? What's my, you know, potential payoff if I'm right with the direction? So that's, again, the vertical spread, bear put, bear call. I'm going to touch on the straddle and strangle a little bit just because they're important strategies, again, sort of like the backspread, at least to be aware of, okay? It's not that, you know, lots of investors, you got to be, you know, pretty savvy and really into the markets, into the option markets pretty significantly to, you know, be doing straddles and strangles, in my opinion, because just like the graph shows, I mean, a strangle, for those of you who don't know, you buy a call, you buy a put. Same underlying, same strike, same expiration. So if we go back to our $50 stock, and let's say, you know, whatever, we get 6 weeks to expiration, maybe the call's, you know, worth $2.50, maybe the put's worth $2.50. With stock rate of 50, the call and the put should be, you know, very close in price. You're tying up $5 or $500 for every straddle in our example. If that stock sits around and does nothing, you know, you're in for a whooping, you know, because, you know, the theta, the time decay in that call and put is going to be significant. But if we're talking about downside protection, this can be, you know, another approach. It's an approach that's actually quite a bit different from the long put, because, you know, we're buying a long call as protection. If we've got a flat out long portfolio, we may not need to just do the long call. But if we don't really have an underlying position and we're looking for a downside market, you know, considering a long straddle is a reasonable play, as is the next strategy we'll touch on, the long strangle. And whether you know it or not, every time you trade an option, you know, whether you're long it or short it, means that you have a volatility position, because every option has vega. And if you're long options, you're long vega, typically, although, you know, you get into a more complex, larger position, that may not be true. But generally speaking, long option positions are typically long vega. Short option positions are typically short vega. So if you're anticipating a big downward move in the market, long straddle and strangle positions can be very, very profitable. And again, the long straddle, you can see, you know, the blue line, the blue chart, they right at the same strike. So our $50 stock would be long the $50 call and the 50 put, and that's how that would work. So you can see with the simulator, you're making money both ways as long as the stock is moving somewhat significantly. If we paid $5 for the straddle, you know, each day we're going to have time decay in the call and the put. So, you know, we need that stock over a fairly short period of time at some point, you know, to start to move in order to offset the time decay. That's really the risk with the straddle and the strangle, is the vega, the volatility risk. So, again, those of you getting maybe started with options, or you know, try to get familiar, go back to that OIC website, optionseducation.org, under the tool and resource bar that I referenced earlier, you know, look at implied and historic volatility charts. They will give you a sense for where the time premium levels are with your options. And if you're considering buying a strangle or a straddle, you want to have a sense for whether those options are priced, you know, the low side, midpoint, or the high side. Most options right about now, with all the movement in the markets, you know, the time premiums are significantly more than they were a few months ago, and that's just because of the movements. So the difference between a strangle and a straddle, take a look at the chart there on the right-hand side. You can see, unlike you know, the lines to the downside and the upside coming to a V, here we've got, you know, a bit of a cup or a saucer, and that's because the straddle, you buy the call and the put at the same strike. With the strangle, you buy the call, the higher priced call, higher price meaning the higher strike call, and the lower strike put. So that's why you still get that same significant profit potential on a big move in the stock, but you've got a larger area, the difference between those strikes, where if you get to expiration and the stock is still inside those strikes, you'll have lost the premium you paid. Back to our $50 stock, if we're buying the strangle, sort of a delta neutral where the calls and the puts have a similar delta, we would be buying the 55 call out of the money by $5, and the 45 put out of the money by $5 as well, with that stock at 50. Again, the 55 call represents the right to buy stock at 55. The 45 put represents the right to sell stock at 45. So that's why the chart is quite different from the straddle versus the strangle. Always remember, same expiration, whether you're doing straddles or strangles, same expiration. So you can see with the simulator, very similar. Stock moves big. These positions tend to do very, very well. So now we'll get into last three strategies, okay? Long stock, long puts. And I've got three different examples here of long stock and long puts. And it speaks to fundamental position in options around your stock. In our first one, we're long 500 shares of stock. And you can see that white line, you know, in the simulator represents the stock, making money to the upside, losing money to the downside. The red line represents the five long puts. So you can see to the right side of the graph, the red line goes horizontal. That's the debit we pay for the five puts. And at some point, those puts to the downside, because depending on where our strike price was, and we're talking about an at-the-money strike here, in the $50 stock, if we've got five $50 puts, whatever the premium for those puts was, it would, let's say, you know, they cost a dollar each, which would be fairly inexpensive depending on the amount of time left, we'd be tying up $500 against our long 500 shares. So if the stock at expiration was below $50, we'd be able to offset our long stock with those five long puts. So we're not going to make any money to the downside. We're going to protect our 500 shares with those 500 puts worth of insurance. So that's long stock, long puts. I'd say one for one. Here we're looking at, and notice the red line. Notice how, you know, its upside potential picks up significantly to the downside. And that's because here we've still got those 500 shares of long stock, but now we've got 10 of the at-the-money puts. So we've got a ratio 2-to-1. So, you know, what do we have? Notice, I mean, I guess you can't see it too well on that graph, but the red line is twice as low as it was on the right side because our premiums are twice as great as they were for the five puts. Not only are we offsetting our loss in the long stock to the downside, we're long five additional at-the-money puts. So that's why the red line, you know, starts to increase quite a bit more than the losses that are shown with the white line in the long stock. So that's, you know, 500 shares of stock, 10 long puts. But again, maybe those puts don't cost a dollar. Maybe they cost $2 or $3 for that at-the-money put. Again, depending on how much time. So the question you have to ask yourself or ask your broker, I want downside protection. What am I willing to pay for that downside protection? Or also, are there ways I can, you know, use options that maybe don't cost as much as some other ways in terms of formulating downside protection? Clearly, when we start to go into a ratio, so we were 1-to-1, we were 2-to-1, and now in this example, we're 3-to-1. We're getting, you know, possibly we're getting greedy to the downside, long three puts for every 100 shares of long stock. You can see as the stock, you know, starts to fall, the value of those puts is going to increase, so we're going to make more money to the downside. Things you can do, and again, this is probably getting a little more advanced, but if you have a position where, and again, you know, positions, most position, option positions are closed out prior to expiration. So you put things on. It doesn't mean you have to hold this thing all the way to expiration. If you've, you know, got 500 shares of long stock and you've got 15 long puts, that means you've got 10 net long puts that you can potentially trade against. I mean, if you're going to stay, you know, on a one-to-one basis. So, you know, if that stock starts to drop, maybe you sell some of the 50 puts. Maybe you, depending on your opinion of the underlying, you could turn that 50 put into a 50-45 put spread, and maybe you sell 10 of the 45 puts to offset the cost of those extra 10 50 puts, at least to a point. So there are lots of different things that you can do. The idea is really to suggest that options do allow for lots of flexibility. If you're not sure what might be the right next step. If you've got a broker, ask them, and you know, and then continue to work, you know, on tools like the position simulator, where you can develop, you know, some potential strategies as you know, underlyings go your way and you happen to be net long options. Two more strategies before we go to Nick with questions. The back spread, and you know, there's a call back spread, there's a put back spread. It's basically for sure a forecast looking for a sharp move lower in the underlying. And again, you know, getting used to the lingo and things like that can be a little bit intimidating at first, but a put back spread is very simply, it's a bull put spread where you own the higher strike, sell the lower strike. And on top of that, it's, you know, selling that higher strike put and buying a bunch of lower strike puts. And then it's just a question of what ratio do you want. Now, there are risks with these. You know, when you're net long options, there may not be, you know, you still can be net long options in some positions. I mean, if you're selling $10 options and buying $2 options, you could buy five options for every one you sold, if it's a $10 you're selling and a $2 one you're buying. But the risk comes in where that stock goes out at expiration or before, which is going to drive the value of, you know, the short put or the long puts. And that's where really the homework comes in with the back spread, whether it's a call or a put back spread. So again, here it's about with the puts, let's go back to our $50 stock. In a typical putback spread, we would sell something like the at-the-money put. So we'd sell the 50 puts and buy the 45 puts, but we'd buy more of them. And so we need that stock to go significantly below 45 in order for us to make money, unless we get to do this thing for a credit, and I'll kind of show you how that works. But the whole idea here is, you know, net long puts, you know, because we're talking downside again. You can do the same thing, you know, on the call side. Selling one strike, buying a lower strike with the puts, and having net long puts in the position. And that's really what a back spread is all about. You know, this shows you, as I mentioned, let's look at the lines, the dotted lines to the right. If you're able to do, you know, sell the puts and then buy the puts, depending on the ratio you do, you might be able to do it for a net credit. So you have the possibility, depending on where the stock goes out, even if the stock doesn't, you know, not crash, but head south in a meaningful way, if it stays close to where you put the position on, you could net out that credit and actually make money, even though what happened in the stock didn't really happen according to your forecast. So you can make that net credit. You can also do it for even money, or at the same time do it for a debit. But you know what the graph shows is the long strike back to our 50-45 put back spread. We've sold the 50 puts. We've bought the 45 puts. If we hold this position and that stock towards expiration is at 45, let's say, you know, a couple days before expiration, the stock's at 45, what's the value of that 50 put? Well, it's $5, right? Because the 50 put is the right to sell stock at 50. That's worth $5 plus maybe a little bit of time premium. But the 45 puts that you bought with the stock at 45 right at expiration, they're not worth much. So I'm sure you paid a handsome price for those puts. They've decayed to the point of not having much value because the stock is right at the strike at expiration or close to it. So there can be significant loss depending on, you know, your ratio, depending on the debit, credit, or even money spread that you do it for. So that's why I say the back spread idea is a good one. It's not one that is necessarily used that often by retail investors, but I think the concept, I like to talk about it because the concept makes sense. You're net long in this example puts, can do the same things for calls. You're looking for a big move in the underlying, and if you get that, you're going to be net long puts, short stock, you know, below 45. you know, if you did that on a 1:3, 1:4, or 1:5 ratio for each tick below 45, you know, your net long, or excuse me, your net short, all the long puts that you have through that put back spread. So, you know, that's the philosophy behind the whole idea of back spreads. You obviously are not going to be doing these unless you are quite bearish, if we're talking, you know, the put side. So, again, the trade-off can be not insignificant loss if that stock finishes at your long strike. Here's some examples. You know, the stock at $47, you know, you sell the in-the-money put for $4, you buy two of the 45 puts for $1.50. You know, your net credit is $1, okay? So depending on where the stock goes out, you know, if it's 49 or higher, you can take in that net credit of $1. But in this example, the stock's got to be below 41, you know, for you to be starting to make, you know, significant money. And, you know, this is your maximum loss, your break-even, and also your downside break-even. And, you know, here's an idea. You know, that stock at 47, you've got to get to 41 and 49 before you're making money. The reason you're making money at 49 and higher is because you were able to do that spread for a $1 credit. In between, you've got some significant losses. And then to the downside, that's where you start to make real money. And that's the point of the put back spread. Net long puts, going to make real money to the downside if that's what happens. And, you know, here's just another slide to represent the various ratios and, you know, the possible profit and losses. As I mentioned, these are more complicated than much of what we typically talk about. So if you're going to try them, please go to the position simulator, plug in different strikes, different ratios, and if you're comfortable, have at it, please. Last thing before, again, we turn over to Nick for questions, we'll talk about the collar. Now, the collar is not going to give us, you know, a big downside win. What the collar is going to do is lock in potential profits from stocks that have run up or any kind of underlying an index that maybe have run up. The collar, for those of you who don't know, is two strategies in one. You've got the covered call, so we're long the underlying and short a call at whatever strike we deem appropriate. And then the other part of that strategy is the long put. And again, the reason we use a collar is to try to lock in, for the most part, profits in underlyings that have done well for us. So back to our $50 stock. Let's say we bought it at 40. It's run to 50. We have some nervousness about the underlying. We could sell the 50 call. We could sell the 55 call against that long stock. And then to offset you know, the downside and to kind of lock in our profit. If the stock's right at 50 and, you know, we've got a significant profit, you could potentially just sell the 50 call and turn around and buy the 50 put and do that collar. You could also potentially sell the 55 call, buy the 50 put with the handsome profit of $10. That wouldn't be unreasonable. You'd clearly be doing that for a debit, but you'd know that you would be out of the position at the strike minus the debit you paid for that collar. So collar, again, is for the most part a position where we try to defend and lock in profits and underlyings that have gone up. So we're long the underlying. We sell a call for every 100 shares of stock that we own. And the key there is to pick which strike that we want to sell. And, again, that strike will represent the point at which we are potentially obligated to sell the stock. If your opinions change, you can always roll out of one strike into another, but it's long stock, short call, and then the protection to the downside is turning around and buying that additional put. So, you know, that's what the collar is all about. And in terms of what price you do the collar for, it's really completely going to depend on what strikes you choose. So similar to the back spread, it can be a net debit. You could do it for even money, zero cost collar. You may hear that term. or you can do it for a credit as well. So I think from a downside strategy point, that may kind of wrap us up. Nick, happy to take some questions, hoping we have a few.
Absolutely, Joe. But before we get to those, I do want to remind our listeners that if they have further questions about the concepts that we discussed today or any of the tools on the OIC website, including that position simulator, you can always contact our investor services team at options@theocc.com. They're ready to help answer questions about options strategies or positions. Additionally, our webinars are available on the OIC YouTube channel, so you can review a number of strategies and concepts at your own pace. And with that, Joe, let's get to it. We do have a number of questions, and I think a lot of our listeners today are very practical investors, and a couple of them wanted to know about profits. Obviously, that's what people are listening for. They want to know how to make the largest profits. And with this volatility and some drop-offs in the market, what are the strategies today that you discussed are the ones that allow you to have the highest upside when the market is dropping significantly?
Okay, good question. The largest profits with the markets dropping significantly. Let's take a step back. You know, what's going to give us the most profit, you know, with the market dropping significantly? Well, long puts, right? So, you know, try to always think big picture when you're talking, you know, just when you're talking trading, you know, really think big picture. And, you know, to the downside, your biggest profits are clearly going to come from long puts. And so that's why I was trying today to, you know, touch upon, we very rarely talk about, you know, a position where we're long stock and then long 15 puts. But the idea is to just be able to, okay, wow, that's different. What happened, you know? Now, clearly, it costs a heck of a lot more than long stock and long puts, or it costs a lot more than a bear put spread. But when we talk about, you know, trying to maximize downside, you know, one, you go back to, okay, I'm going to be long puts and maybe long options. I mean, again, big picture, we talked about straddle and strangle. They're expensive. But what happens when the market really tanks? Vols go up. And what I mean by vols is, you know, the implied volatility of options, the time premium component. So even though, you know, when the market's tanking, sure, you know, the puts are going up and hopefully going up quite a bit, both a combination of intrinsic value and time premium. But the calls, I mean, the calls go down in value, but they go down less in value because the time premium levels continue to expand. Go to the pricing calculator, you know, plug in your favorite stocks, plug in the current implied volatility, look at the value of the 30-day call and put, and then double the implied volatility in that pricing calculator and see what happens to the value of those calls. Doubling may be too extreme. It happens. Doesn't happen often. But, you know, go to those implied volatility charts. Look at the lows. Look at the highs of your implied vol over the last 1 year. That's what the charts show you. 1 year implieds. You know, plug in the lowest point, plug in the highest point, and see the difference in those option prices just with a change in implied. And that implied, you know, is a big, big way to play defense in the market. So we're talking long option strategies, which means almost always long volatility strategies. And, you know, the market has skew. That's where, you know, if you're into the back spread, the put back spread, one of the things I didn't talk about because this gets a little more advanced, but the further out of the money that put, the higher the skew in those out of the money puts. So you get even more juice and more time premium in those out of the money puts because of the natural skew of the marketplace. So, Nick, to kind of wrap up the answer to that question, it's long options. It's long puts, and by all means, be aware of the implied volatility levels.
Thanks, Joe. I'm glad you mentioned the position simulator and some of the other tools we have on the OIC website, because one of our listeners today wanted to know some more detail about that. Specifically, does the position simulator give you probabilities of in, at, and out of the money calculations?
It does not, but there are other, I guess there are tools out there at some of the various brokers that do offer that, and I would just suggest Google exactly what you're looking for there, your probability calculator, and I'm sure you'll come up with a handful of different examples.
Joe, is there a simple or relatively simple way that an investor can track volatility on a given position?
Heck yes. Now, there, without getting too complicated, vol positions change as the underlying changes because each option and Nick, you and I have talked about this before, and I know we've done some volatility presentations. Each option has a volatility, a vega value. Each strike, has a little different vega value than another strike. The further out in time you go, the more vega value. So, one snapshot in time can give you X vega, and another point in time or price in the underlying, your vega can change because vegas are dynamic. They do change. So that's one thing. Again, with the position simulator, plug in. If you're just long options, then you're just flat out long volatility. Let's go back to the back spread. Stocks at 50. So we're short one, 50 put. We're long three of the 45 puts. With the stock at 50, we're going to be close to a delta neutral vega position. Okay? Delta neutral with vegas. And just like, deltas in your underlying, you have delta vega. So as the stock moves to that 45 strike, the vega in those 45 puts increases, so your vega position increases. So we're getting a little further along here, Nick, in terms of understanding of options. But one of the great things about the option product is its dynamic component. And volatility, to me, is the most exciting dynamic part of the option pricing model.
Thanks, Joe. We're just at our 60-minute mark, but I think we'll take one last question. And I think that this is going to be of general interest to a number of our listeners here. On a relative basis, Joe, and compared to some other strategies that you've talked about, how much risk are we looking at when we're talking about straddles and strangles?
Well, we're talking about, I can't talk in terms of percentage, but I can talk, it's the debit. So if the options are $2 each, you're paying $4 for the straddle. The strangle prices, maybe the calls and puts are out of the money. Maybe they're $1.25 each. Maybe it's 250. So, your price is the debit you pay. And so that's where I think I was emphasizing quite a bit, the whole idea of insurance, how much do you need? But, as important and maybe more important, what the heck are you willing to spend on that insurance? Now, when we're talking straddles and strangles, just like we talked about with the 500 shares versus the 10 or 15 puts, you're long a call, you're long a put. You can always sell a call and sell a put to offset your long strangle or straddle to kind of hedge that position. Okay, because you're still then one for one. You're not going to have unlimited or significant profit potential beyond a certain point once you start selling options against your long options. But that's another way to trade long option positions. You're net long them. Something happens. Rather than, sell out of the position, maybe you roll into various diagonal or vertical spreads to offset some of that time decay. So that's a different approach.
Joe, thanks for your time and expertise today. Do you have any final parting thoughts for our listeners?
I wish everybody the best. They're very, very, very challenging markets. Long option positions can be very helpful in times like this. Short option positions can be quite challenging because the speed of the market movements.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for your time today. While we weren't able to get to all of your questions, we do have our investor services desk ready to help, and you can reach out to them at options@theocc.com. And our webinars are also available on the OIC YouTube channel, so you can review a number of option strategies at your own pace. Many of you also asked about further education. Please visit our website, optionseducation.org, and see the Getting Started section for further reading. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you again for attending, and we hope to see you again next time.